Blackstone Publishing presents Tenemental, Adventures of a Reluctant Landlady by Vikki Warner. This book is read by Rebecca Mitchell.
Author's Letter. Hi, audiobook listeners. Vikki Warner here, author of Tenemental. Thank you for choosing this little audiobook out of all the options you have before you. Are you sure you don't want to listen to, like, Harry Potter or something? No, you chose this audiobook, and that's awesome. So before I send you into the world of Tenemental, I thought I'd tell you a little something about the making of this audiobook. I'm proud to say this was a fully Providence, Rhode Island-based endeavor. My good friend Reba Mitchell did a stellar job narrating, and that makes sense, seeing as she not only has a golden voice and a ton of narration experience, she's also the landlady of a home remarkably like mine. She knows of what she reads. Oh, and who's that over there at the controls? That's Joelle Thibodeau, a wonderful musician and audio engineer who has his own lengthy relationship with our city. Between the three of us, we have a combined 42 years living in Providence. We've all known each other at least a decade. We drank a combined 15 cans of seltzer during the making of this recording, and we only needed to break once for Joelle's dog, Rummy, to go outside for a number one. I sat on the couch and listened the whole time, occasionally scratching Rummy's neck while these two virtuosos did the heavy lifting. In the meantime, I got a renewed perspective on just how much of a marathon making an audiobook really is. Also, in our moments of downtime, Joelle, Reba, and I reminisced about some of our early memories of Providence, and this familiar, mellow feeling came over me, one that said, "Take comfort in this, the shared histories you have with these fellow citizens of this little corner of the world. We three have so many people in common in this small city, and the collective feeling of that is like a big net of hands ready to catch you if you fall. It's beautiful luck to be here." Okay, Reba, take it away. Long live Providence. Thank you all.
To my parents, who never take on more house than they can handle, and to DL, who proved more than willing to. Author's note. I have changed the names of many, but not all, of the people in this book. Some have given express permission for their real names to be used. In some instances, I stepped out of the actual chronology of events, assembling a timeline that would benefit the larger story. I consulted with some of the people who appear here, both to check my memory and bring to mind further details. Outside of those caveats, this book is a true account of my experience as I remember it. Preface. Imagine you own a large house. It's a charming, old place with many rooms and decent enough bones. Not stately, but attractive in its old-world, banged-up way, and historically significant to its neighborhood. Now imagine that, as in a hazy Stevie Nicks music video dream sequence complete with gauzy fabrics, silver bangles, and skeleton keys, you breathlessly try every door, but you can't gain access to most of its rooms. They remain locked. Secret. You stand dejectedly by. You're the mistress of this domain, but you're also the interloper. This is the life of a landlady. This is my life. I have chosen to own a complicated home. Over many years of gazing at closed doors, I've stopped worrying so much about what might be behind them. In the interest of my mental health, I've categorically stopped trying to fix whatever might be wrong back there. If I catch a whiff of rankness emanating from behind a closed door, I do not obsess over the piles of crusty socks, stale cigarette butts, and elderly pizzas that probably caused it. I just go to my own little cluster of rooms, burn some Palo Santo, put some caulk on something, and live my own damn life. I've worked for years to come to this point of blissful, possibly counterproductive detachedness. I'm countering my natural state in doing so, a default setting that for years had me worrying over every little creak and every little crack. But no matter how diligently I try to disengage, I still occasionally awaken at 4 a.m., adrenaline pumping, with the certainty that the house is literally crashing down around me. Prologue. In August 2004, when I was in my mid-20s, I bought an abused, 100-year-old, three-family apartment building in the Federal Hill neighborhood of Providence, Rhode Island, New England's third-largest and first freakiest city. I've lived on the third floor and rented out the two apartments below ever since. It's a standard triple-decker, that dime-a-dozen housing paradigm first built to shelter immigrant mill workers, visible everywhere in urban New England, and by the hundreds in my own neighborhood. Between endless repairs, unruly tenants, a trashed, party-heavy neighborhood described as troubled on the local news, break-ins, serial neighborhood house fires, accidents, and just paying the bills, the house has been a needy bitch. And although the two of us are still standing, maintaining our uneasy partnership has been a struggle from the get-go, often hindering my other relationships and causing me to question the very trajectory of life. Is it all worth it just to have this big, unwieldy house? Just to stick with this maddening yet adorable friend who is the very definition of high maintenance? Exactly which of my life goals am I fulfilling by ignoring the mile markers other people use to measure their lives and opting, instead, to coddle a cranky and battered apartment building in a downtrodden neighborhood of a small post-industrial American city? And why? Why do I find it acceptable to rent apartments to people who smoke crack or break bathtubs with sledgehammers? That's right. This story's not just about me and my crumbling ancient house. It's about me, my crumbling ancient house, and a host of other disoriented humans stumbling through their third and fourth decades herewith. Starting out as a landlady, I didn't have siblings, a spouse, or kids. No sweat, I thought. Who needs such fetters when I have the volatile frisson of living with renters? As I age, my tenants get younger. As I get more settled in life, they become more erratic. It's all very my first apartment around here. A dude-centric assemblage of cigarette butts, beer cans, Black Sabbath, and Rock Band. Their cumulative comings and goings have shown a light for me into the reaches of the modern young male brain. It's dry kindling in there, and I'm just trying to keep it from sparking up. I find myself attempting to predict my tenants' next erratic moves, hoping against hope that they're not trashing their apartments, and living in a state of low-simmering paranoia that something may catch fire or explode at their hands. I do not exaggerate when I say that a tenant's late-night burnt toast once brought me to engage in a militaristic sweep of the house. Over the decade or so since this house has been in my name, I've filled it with an outlandish array of people, 80% male, and animals, 60% feline, punk farmers, herbalists, body piercers, musicians who play metal, punk, country rock.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.